Most people don't make a comeback with drugs, but Johann Hari is an exception to the rule. He was an award-winning young journalist, and then in 2011, it all came crashing down. He was outed as plagiarising his interview quotes from old articles. He quit, he handed back the prizes, and went away to travel the world. There he met drug dealers, mob hitmen, and doctors, all to explore how our war on drugs globally is failing badly.
Tell me a little bit about where your relationship with drugs begins.
Yeah, one of my earliest memories is I tried to wake up one of my relatives and not being able to, and I was too young then to understand why, but as I got older I realised we had addiction in my family, in fact other members of my family as well. And I guess when I started work on this book 4 years ago, I kind of thought, oh, I know loads about this subject, right? Like I'd lived it in my family and I'd written quite a lot about it as a journalist, but I suddenly realised there were loads of incredibly basic questions I didn't know the answer to, like, why did we go to war against drug addicts and drug users 100 years ago? Why do we carry on when it's so obviously failing? And what really causes drug use and drug addiction? And I couldn't find the answers in what I was reading, so I went on this big journey. And I guess the main thing I realised is almost everything we think we know on this subject is wrong. Drugs are not what we think they are. Addiction is not what we think it is. The war on drugs is not what we think it is. And the alternatives to the war on drugs aren't what we think they are either.
Okay, well, let's start with what we don't know. Tell me what it is that most people get wrong about their understanding of that notion of addiction.
Well, I got it wrong as well. If you'd said to me 4 years ago, what causes, say, heroin addiction? I think I would have looked at you like you were a bit simple-minded and I would have said, well, the clue's in the title, right? Heroin addiction is obviously caused by heroin. We've been told a story that's become part of our common sense. We think if the next 20 people to walk past this studio all took heroin together for 20 days, on day 21, they'd all be heroin addicts because there are chemical hooks in the heroin that their bodies would start to physically need and desperately crave. I didn't understand it until I went to Vancouver and met this extraordinary professor of psychology called Bruce Alexander. He explained to me the idea we've all got in our heads comes from a series of experiments that were done earlier in the 20th century. You get a rat and you put it in a cage and you give it two water bottles. One is just water and the other is water laced with either heroin or cocaine. If you do that, the rat will almost always prefer the drugged water and almost always kill itself quite quickly. So there you go, right? It's our story about addiction. But in the 70s, Professor Alexander came along and said, well, hang on a minute, we're putting these rats in an empty cage. They've got nothing to do except use these drugs. Let's see if what would happen if we change this. So he built a cage that he called Rat Park, which is basically heaven for rats, right? Anything a rat could possibly want in life is there in Rat Park. They've got loads of friends, they can have loads of sex, they've got loads of cheese, they've got loads of colored balls, and they've got both the water bottles, the normal water and the drug water. But this is the fascinating thing. In Rat Park, they don't like the drug water. They almost never use it. None of them ever use it compulsively. The main thing I take from that is that the opposite of addiction is not sobriety. The opposite of addiction is connection. There are some people who say we shouldn't even call it addiction. We should call it bonding. Human beings have an innate need to bond and connect. And when we're happy and healthy, we'll bond and connect with each other. But if you can't do that because you're isolated or traumatized or beaten down by life, you will bond and connect with something that gives you some sense of relief and you'll keep coming back to it.
So where does recreational social drug use fall in that spectrum then? Because what you're describing is like a straight line to down and out drug use, whereas there's a whole spectrum of drug use that exists before that where people do it with friends, with people. Where does that sit on the spectrum for you?
It's crucially important. Now, the UN Office of Drug Control are the main drug war people in the world, right? Even they admitted a few years ago, 90% of all currently banned drug use is non-problematic. It doesn't make you addicted, it doesn't screw up your health. So you've got to ask what's going on with that 10 to 15% who do develop a problem. It's not the chemical hooks, it's the underlying pain and isolation in their lives. And that's what you need to turn around. And in case this sounds a bit kind of fancy and abstract, you know, there are countries that have built policies based on these insights. In the year 2000, Portugal had one of the worst drug problems in Europe. 1% of the population was addicted to hard drugs. Much worse problem than what's going on here in Australia at the moment. And every year they tried the drug war way more. They arrested and imprisoned more people. And every year the problem got worse. One day, the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition got together and said, look, we can't go on like this. What are we going to do? They set up a panel of scientists and doctors and they said, figure out what would genuinely solve this problem. And we've agreed in advance that we'll do whatever you recommend. Took it out of politics. And it came back and said, decriminalise all drugs, from cannabis to ice, but and this is the crucial next step. Take all the money we currently spend on making addicts' lives worse and spend it instead on turning their lives around. We take addicts, we give them criminal records, we make it really hard for them to get jobs. What they did in Portugal was they set up a massive program of job creation for addicts. Say you used to be a mechanic. They'll go to a garage and they'll say, if you employ this guy for a year, we'll pay half his wages. They set up a huge program of microloans for addicts so they could set up small businesses. The goal was to say to every addict in Portugal, we love you, we value you, we want you back, we want you as part of the society. We want you to have something to get out of bed for in the morning. And it's now, in a couple of months, it'll be 15 years since this experiment began, and the results are in. Injecting drug use is down by 50%, 50%. Overdose deaths are massively down. Suddenly you realise why the war on drugs approach is failing so badly.
Johan Harry, columnist for The Independent, he was accused on a blog last week of taking quotes from the writings of his interviewees.
I'm afraid he's been an idiot.
And passing them off as having been said to him during his interviews.
How frustrating is it to you that the easiest criticism anybody can make of you is disgraced former journalist with The Independent?
I don't think that's happened. It's interesting. So obviously with the book, I've put up all the interviews that I did, the hundreds of interviews I did, the audio from all of them is there. You know, I think when a book is endorsed by people as varied as like a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist like Glenn Greenwald, Naomi Klein, lots of police chiefs, I'm pleased it's the only book that's ever been endorsed by both Noam Chomsky and Elton John. I tried to persuade them to sing a duet in honour of it, but Noam wasn't up for it. Yes.
Johan Harry, thanks for talking to us.
Oh, thank you very much. Cheers.